was yet in a university in Croatia. And he's going to talk about the comparison of Harry Saltzman's double productions of representation of the British spy based on 3 James Bond movies and 3 Harry Potter adaptations. Thank you very much.
Why is James Bond so interesting, and why is Harry Potter so boring? Because Michael Caine tried to find out which name would be very close to the definition of the character, unnamed character, in Three Novels by the less famous author, Landig. Let me now show my presentation, and then we can talk and we can discuss various topics here. And that's the title. How come these three works of fiction and three adaptations plus three adaptations? The same production here by Harry or Herschel Saltzman, and the fact that in cooperation with Broccoli he earned more than $300 million, and with these three adaptations of Harry Palmer he earned some $4.5 million, and one of them was a financial flop. So I wanted to see the reasons for commercial financial success and reasons for less successful production with this character, Harry Palmer. We have simultaneous production, co-production, and we have here two movie stars today, Sir Sean Connery and Sir Michael Caine. And we know that the casting was not by Harry Saltzman, but he played the job, and I believe he agreed with the choices. We have three adaptations, and we all have seen the films Goldfinger, Thunderball, and You Only Live Twice. I know there is this shared authorship, but nevertheless, let's skip it. The box office success of these movies crossed the line of $100 million. Both the literary author Fleming and the movie star Connery could continue their work with rising popularity. You know, there were previous James Bond adaptations, and after the crossing this line of $100 million, Harry Saltzman started this Harry Palmer. Is it trilogy? Is it a tetralogy, possibly? Or he tried to see what happens? I don't know. On the other hand, we can analyze Michael Caine's representations of the British spy Harry Palmer in the film and the interpretations of the novels here, his three novels. Less successful, less fruitful. We must stress that the first adaptation, the IPCRS-ESS file, is on the list of the best British films. Was the trilogy a plan? What if the series had been successful? Would then a new franchise called Harry Potter have been created? I don't know. I have many questions here. Saltzman could earn much money together with Broccoli from the Bond franchise, so he could afford to lose money with Berlin, I don't know. But I'm interested in the intentions why to simultaneously try to produce another type of British spy on the screen. Although Hamilton directed both Goldfinger and Journal in Berlin, the response of the audiences was different. And the aim of this paper is to try to find out the reasons for this discrepancy. We have the problem with anti-hero spy. with Harry Palmer. Harry still his own moral scruples and questions, rather modernist type in contrast with postmodernist type. That's my view of James Bond. Unpleasant histories, issues like the Holocaust in this novel, his possession of Jews during the Second World War, compensations between Jewish claims, guilt of the international banking and of Swiss banks. So we have many rather complicated issues, and films and novels with such heavy issues cannot be very popular, except if you have Spielberg and other stars who made films on the world. I look on the successful series, co-production with Albert Broccoli, based James Bond actor Sean Connery, and then concept of franchising and innovative repetitions of paradigmatic situations, characters, humor. Every new James Bond film was a test. What was new? What was a new music, film music, a new song, new trick in certain situations? This makes franchising very profitable because you just use some variations and you achieve some points in adaptation. Partially, also this aesthetics of commercials and promoting sales of entertainment magic technological gadgets by Star Spy, film music and songs performed by international stars. We have design in introductory credits and we have design in final credits, aesthetics of hetero erotism, humor and charm, excellent choreography of men's fighting, unlike in the trilogy, let's say. It's called Trilogy with Harry Palmer. There are scenes that that are there rather amateur on this level of amateur productions. I look at the commercial and unsuccessful three-part Harry Palmer series, the quality choreography of men's fighting too obvious. Some or many scenes should have been reshot for reasons of overall persuasiveness or audio recordings. Too much irony or sarcasm. The British spy is born in the game of the big players. We don't have a star here. No star spy, and possibly that's the reason for lack of attraction. British spies as an anti-hero, Harry Palmer has no license to kill. He rather avoids killings. Michael Caine's acting without identification, positive features, spy roles, no background message, follow me, be like me. It's no serious to teach potential future British spies how to behave as heroes. I don't know how to win. And my problem is not adequate film music compared to James Bond series. This is really poor, in my opinion, my personal opinion. And bad box office here. Harry Palmer series with $3 million for the first film, no data for Funeral in Berlin, and Million Dollar Brain, I don't know if it's okay, if it's true, $1.5 million, some say it was financial fraud. And James Bond series with more than $300 million, almost $400 million. Profit from these productions. The same in both series, Harry Saltzman, film director Guy Hamilton, only in Berlin. And how come that Godfrey could earn $125 million and film in Berlin nothing? No Broccoli, no profit, no Connery, no profit, no film music and songs, no profit. I don't know. Differences in initial budgets in the series, I don't know. Possibly James Bond and franchising from the start. Contribution of Broccoli in the James Bond series, possibly even after the death of Saltzman. Hero versus anti-hero of the main characters. Two Oscar winners with Goldfinger and Thunderbolt for special effects, sound effects, and the visual effects. And the success of the first adaptation, it's on the list of the best British films. I would also like to put this question in front of you. Different social origin status of two writers in the measure of investment and money and talent by adapters. And now one Fleming's of origin from a wealthy family, and then Leighton's father's a chauffeur and mechanic, mother a part-time cook, or it was not important, you know. How to make books and characters of an author with less privileges in life from the start more attractive and successful than the books and characters of an author from a rich family enjoying best possible society and connections in the British intelligence community? This did not play any role. Commercially successful books and films do not treat difficult matters and do not reveal too deep truths. They do not provoke, they cooperate. Len Dayton is otherwise. He reveals too much and lets his unnamed hero, baptized Harry Palmer and film adaptations by Michael Caine and director Harry Zaltzman, the criteria was the name must be boring and the character must be boring. And Zaltzman said, okay, it can be like my name Harry because of my real name is Herschel. It's not okay. Let it happen. But unpleasant question, like a point of ex-Nazis, Reinhard Gehl's influence in international intelligence organizations after the Second World War, etc. Two general conclusions. Too many reasons for the success of James Bond franchise. The three films in comparison with the intellectual provocation of Harry Palmer productions. Too many reasons for the commercial failure of the Harry Palmer trilogy. Money Penny is better than Jean, M is better than Palmer's superiors, Deus Ex Machina, superpotent technological gadgets are not in the hands of Harry Palmer. James Bond is an interesting winner, Harry Palmer is a boring intellectual loser. Harry Zaltzman proves to be a double agent in experimenting with two different types of British spy models. He co-produced the superhero Beyond Good and Evil when it comes to shooting without previous legal procedures, and he produced the skeptic spy character declining £800 a vote to buy himself a new car at the same time. Harry Zaltzman's double productions show the film producers' openness for alternative optics and self-criticism on part what can be defined as the victors of the Second World War. Both mainstream entertainment and inclusion of the reception of the audiences, for example, in Japan, and on the other hand, existential questions and absurd visions. Sometimes you have money, much money, team with broccoli, and sometimes you just let Michael Caine distract Sean Connery's positive image of the British spy on the screen three times. Commercial failure guaranteed, except the first adaptation. We have three films in comparison, three films at the same time, the same producer, we have one franchise series, and we have a try to make possible competition to Ian Fleming, but without any real chances here. That's the end of my presentation. What I can repeat from all the talks today is that British spy is somewhere in the middle between America and the Soviet Union. And we have the same topic in James Bond films and here in adaptations of Harry Palmer. And what strikes me is a quote that Len Dayton puts before his book, Film of Berlin. Quote, Alan Dulles, then director of the CIA. You, Mr. Chairman, may have seen some of my intelligence reports from time to time. Mr. Khrushchev, I believe we get the same reports, and probably from the same people. Mr. Dulles, maybe you should pool our efforts. Mr. Khrushchev, yes. We should buy our intelligence data together and save money. we have to pay the people we want. Intelligence business is trade, it's international, and it's, I don't know, some kind of racketeering between the West and East America and communism, capitalism, or which power is in the middle, I don't know, Tito's movement of non-alignment to blocks after the collapse of communism. There is no clear orientation, there is no coordinating system anymore. I think James Bond and Harry Potter as characters on the screen try to show dilemmas and something that is kind of eternal in this intelligent business of spies. And here a special British spies. Thank you very much.
Can I ask all three panelists to just come to the front to answer some questions and quickly now? Is there questions from the audience to any of the three panel talks that we just heard? Yes?
Well, first of all, thank you all three of you. Very, very interesting. My three questions. I love the Harry Potter ones because to me, they're more believable than him as a spy. And he's from a working class background, not the aspirational upper class adventurer. And to me, it's more real because you even see him discussing his expenses in one of the early things in an office and discussing what time he's going to go on duty, which is much more down to earth. It's more, I'm from a working class background, and I could associate more with that spy because you could believe someone like me becoming that spy, not James Bond.
That's right.
So I think it was also reflected in the production values because James Bond has always been very aspirational. Harry Palmer was not. The only thing that I can say about Harry Palmer, he's shopping in the supermarket and he buys a champignon mushrooms and his boss is saying, you can't afford these mushrooms. That's the only thing I can see. But I think it probably didn't, because the James Bond franchise had taken off, it was almost an anti-James Bond depiction of it. So I don't think it would ever have been as successful because it was to set in the minds of people what a British spy should be.
It was no competition between the two.
No, I understand. But in terms of commercial realisation.
I wondered how come the one producer with much money tried to produce something that would not bring so much money.
But again, but I found all the Harry Potter ones very gritty, very down to earth, very believable.
Yeah, it's very realistic.
Exactly.
I could be Harry Potter too.
But I don't think so. In terms of success or failure, I regard them on an equal basis. Commercially,
it's
from a personal perspective, I like
them. It's like McDonald's, James Bond, McDonald's, etc.
The Palmer films slide a little bit into the bottom register with the last $1 billion break, where it is kind of underground and there's an aspect of
it. It is.
I sort of wonder if maybe they were sort of a bit like, maybe we do need to try and monetize this a bit more. To me, it kind of lost its, some of its kind of essential.
But it depicted the Cold War. I went to Berlin last year. It depicted the Cold War exactly the height of the tension between the East and the West, far more than any James Bond would have done. And I think that's the gritty realism of the way that it was produced.
I think that James Bond's as well were way more stylized in its kind of approach, how they were way more getting that ideal how a spy could work. It's all about aspirational and verisimilitude, where you actually can relate to something. But I found it really interesting to bring up the aspect of wealth that might be actually a socioeconomic background, a success factor. And what I find really interesting is what you raised in your talk is if you have a formula that basically prints you a lot of money, Why would you change it for something that could also print you a lot of money? Unless, and that was my thought after this talk, maybe it was actually something that the that Saltzman wanted to contribute because that is what he believed in, and actually thought this is something he wants to show. He makes enough money with the other series, therefore he could make it as a creative kind of outlet to get a more real perspective for something. He kind of took into account this might not make as much money, at least after the first one we knew it obviously doesn't print as much money. Yes?
Yes, a few observations on that point. Harry Saltzman's restless. He could never stick on one project, and as soon as he got something that was successful, he wanted to go away and do something else. And he'd already been involved in Blue Four films and the British New Wave, in the sense that the Harry Potter films are going back to the early years. Harry said that the New Wave's finished, we're going to do Bond. And probably by 65, he thought Bond was going to finish pretty soon as well. We've got hindsight now, we know that's what it is. But Thunderbolt's at the height of it. But by the time of Ewan twice, the box office started to come down. With the Ipcus found at Funeral in Berlin, they're both announced in the trade paper, the British trade papers, initially as being Eon Productions films. Now, for reasons I don't know, they're then produced independently by Saltzman rather than in partnership with their Broccoli. The Len Dayton novel had been snapped up, possibly even prior to publication, or especially after publication, and commanded a very high premium, so there was an expectation that it was going to be a successful product. And the perceived lack of success, I think probably the Funeral in Berlin was a perfectly middle-of-the-road, okay success at a time when 80% of British films lost money. Billy Dollar Brain just looks as if it's more expensive, I think lost money. But 1966 is the wrong year to be releasing a spy movie. There are 24 spy movies released made from British and American studios before you even count all the European movies. And I think that the declining popularity of the Harry Potter films, the Bond films are starting to decline by 1966. So they've had a bit of time there. But I think the spy thing was really its corpse. It's a big boom in between 64 and 66 when you map through the number of films that it is. I think Funeral in Berlin is caught among a whole, it's Monastery Blaze, it's Pearl Memorandum, it's Spy Who Came in the Cold, it's several of the Man and Uncle films that you put together, theatrical movies and so on. There's just so many spy movies around that it's having its peak, but it's very quickly in decline.
Yeah. It's a saturated market in a certain way, and it spiked afterwards again. But it's really interesting. And my question was, you say in your talk that there were many factors, basically, that made the difference between the success and the unsuccessful series. Would you say that...
Commercially.
But because one of the things I actually realised with both of the series is they have a cult following, actually, behind it, which developed way later for the non-James Bond series. The James Bond series was very successful from the beginning. The other one was more of a slow burner, but still is going, in particular in the British public, as we just heard. I would like to know whether actually, in the longer run, would seem like they're getting closer together commercially as well. Because I feel like a lot of underground watching, underground viewings and kind of back alley cinemas are showing the Palmer one just as often, if not even more often, than James Bond movies. So I find it actually quite interesting to see how that over time developed and might be more of a slow burn instead of saying it's a success story overall. During that time period, I completely agree. But over the longer period of time, the question is whether it might be just a slow burn.
Could be a slow burn, and it depends on the actor.
Yes.
Would you say it's almost been a cult? It's become that sort of genre with Harry Potter is almost like a sub-cult.
You could. The question is, how would you exactly define that then? But it definitely has a cult following. I'd say that is definitely true. But that is true with most spy movies, and one of the questions is then being raised in that direction that I would like to know is, from your talk, because I think you kind of pointed out so well what Britishness in the British spy genre actually mean, which was the, I just wrote down, the chess player and the kind of like, it's an art form that needs to be studied before you can actually become the spy. I would like to know, have you ever looked at how, for example, Americans or Russian movies are constructing the spy to see whether there's difference in the Britishness to the spy?
Not so much Russians, but with some Americans, I think. there's something very quintessential about the English spy and how the English spy or British spy is presented. I think American productions tend to, I think, they lean more towards things like the hard-boiled mode and sort of naturally. And there's a sense of greater agency and cooperation almost. You see different films, there's a real sense of big organisations, but it's almost like very America as a global superpower. We've got so much resource that we put into it, where, you know, time that break, we have to send James Bond to do all this on his own and take out, you know, whole teams of bad guys. But, you know, America's just in control. It'd be interesting to look at the parallel between sort of Russian fiction then.
I thought in your talk it was so interesting how you basically pointed out what those British factors of a spy would be. But I would be interested in, can you actually mirror that and kind of reflect on different backgrounds culturally?
It would be quite interesting. It's
interesting how they actually do a lot of juxtaposition with American instincts, don't they? Because they just
constantly
become these CIA agents who are always just so sort of slipping around that they're not remotely trusting.
No, they've been always quite in control, you know, they know exactly what's going on, and it's kind of big brother, isn't it?
Well, one of the ones that springs to mind about the slickness of an American spy is, I can recall it from the day of the Condor, and it had one of, it's not one of the big Hollywood stars of the Lord of the Open. But yeah, so you can't see him sort of not succeeding in that role, because that was almost like this template.
Yeah, it's, you know, like, I think it comes back to the whole thing about sort of superheroes versus everyman. And I think, particularly with America, they're all superheroes.
Which is really interesting.
Going back to your analogy of the Tinker-Tailor Soldier Spy, I felt that was more of a slow burn. I particularly enjoyed that because it was a bit more like All the President's Men, when you start seeing the underpeer unravel. And it's not like a high action drama, it's more of a cerebral one where you have to take into account all the flashbacks, I think. And I thought it was very similar to that genre.
Yeah.
To me, that could be just as exciting way for the denouement as an under action thriller.
It's just sort of layered, isn't it?
Yeah.
It
did require, I remember seeing it at the time, it did require a lot of mental agility to remember where you were because of the flashbacks.
Yeah, and particularly the TV series is so long, you have to go, it's like, what actually happened? It's like, why did we get to that? And it's, how do all the pieces fit together? And it's interesting with the Tinker-Tailor film, you know, it was talk about secrets, what happened?
Yeah.
I think similar to, you know, Harry Potter, it's kind of like, is there enough of an appetite potentially?
Kind of on the street.
Yeah.
On the street. More brains instead of muscles.
Mm. But with the Bourne franchises and the MI Mission Impossible franchises, they've almost become run of the mill now. Mm. It's just a way of making money, really.
Do we have any other questions? I still have one for Joseph. You basically saw the difference throughout the development. For the first movie, or the first example that you chose, the first series that you chose was a very journalistic kind of approach that you did identify. The second one was more of a sentimental, I think you called it, or human kind of touch one that was more emotion driven. You had on your first list a third one from 2003. Sadly, I couldn't write down the title for you now.
But
was it?
Yes,
I would like to know. Did you basically incorporate that in your overall kind of analysis? And is there another development from the 70s, 80s to like the 2000s? Or yeah, does it follow the same kind of pattern as it did with the journalistic, documentary kind of, or sentimental?
The third one, it's very, it's even more kind of sentimental, melodramatic. So it's those two are just kind of one-off television films for us. Mm-hmm. That was a full-part, Cambridge Boys is a full-part television series. It goes right back to Cambridge and was using the full sort of glamorous, bright head revisited style. And sort of shows them as young idealists sort of pursuing this kind of cause, and there's lots of kind of lush music. It really kind of glamorizes it. So it does, the trajectory follows across all three of them, really.
Would you say that kind of journalistic documentary style for the spy is then actually extinct or doesn't exist anymore? Or would you just say that these are just examples with a coincidental kind of development towards more and more human side, more and more human interest kind of perspective?
I think there's a lot of factors going on there. I struggle to think of from documentaries done in that sort of very sort of embellished way now. I don't know if anyone can think of that, but I struggle. And I think there's something very specific about that kind of old sort of 1970s era British television, when it's much more infused with public service values. Because if you're not television, you've got a whole run of these drama documentaries that were about kind of Cold War topics. And they were quite prolific in town, and then it just goes away about 1980. I didn't actually end up quoting the final one, but I read Derek Padgett's book on docudrama, No Other Ways to Tell It, and he talks about like the docudrama genre sort of getting, in a sense, a bit more like it, as kind of television gets sort of deregulated and gets more dictated by commercial priorities, it becomes a bit more kind of, I don't quite know the words, sort of somewhat more sentimental, somewhat more sensationalist, somewhat more tabloid-esque in its engagement with these sorts of topics. So I think this is a specific example which I think kind of confirms that. Mm-hmm. And there's also other things like, the 1977 film, The Birds of the Plain Film, it's while most of them are still alive, it's while it's still quite fresh in the memory. So maybe there's a sense that it's a sensitive topic and that they really, they're nervous about glamorizing these people, whereas kind of as time lapses and by the time Blunt or Orbar film, you're dead by then, so perhaps it's more safely in the past and you can sort of don't have to worry about upsetting people as much if you take the kind of distances.
So you think it's a distance thing, kind of time distance between how it's being handled?
Yeah,
could be.
That's another factor.
Okay,
it's a lot of things going on here.
Do you think John Mangold's novel that you've been touching on?
I mean, obviously, I have.
It's really, really interesting. I see. He sort of takes Blunt's biography and melds it together with Northern Irish folk and the pieces biography. So he's doing the same kind of thing. He's presenting it as if it's biographical. To do it like being like a documentary, but of course, it's not as fictional.
Yeah.
And I think that's true. The productions you're talking about are fictional, but they're kind of taking this documentary position. Does that make sense, right?
Definitely. The thing about this kind of English wine sort of subgenre is that it's full of all this kind of like slippage between real and fictional, because he's not actually, as I said, a novel, it's not actually using the name Anthony Blunt, even though it's clearly recognizable as him. So it's a little bit of fictional than these, which actually do use the names.
But Blunt and Rainbow's were really good friends at school, and all of them went to Cambridge and all that, but they stayed really good friends for a long time until Lisa's death. But, Anvil uses a lot of biographical evidence. There's a bibliography in the book. So, but it's not like spy fiction generally. It's so connected with the reality, assuming of the novel's square spies and so on. And everybody worries about kind of factual it's very well linked, I believe. But it's a funny kind of relationship to reality, isn't it?
That bit more acute in this case, I think, because you've actually got these kind of people who've led such sort of interesting lives through. Whereas, with Fleming or Le Carré, people who have kind of intelligence background, nobody's quite sort of safe that they actually lived through those two stories in the same one.
Whereas they not the real newspaper, where it was exposed.
Yeah.
Well, what I found interesting, I think it was Cambridge Spies, is a lot of people assume they know why they became spies, but in actual fact, it shows them in the mid-30s. I mean, I for one didn't realise it was a direct, the Cambridge Spies were going into communism as a direct reaction to the growth of fascism in Europe. But if you ask a lot of people why they became spies, that bit doesn't really get covered, does it? It's just the ideological bit.
I think it's because we learned so much about them in the Cold War period, so they're kind of associated with the imagination with the sort of post-war context.
Because you would assume anyone who went to Cambridge was well-to-do, middle class, quite well off. So why would they gravitate towards communism?
Yeah.
But it's very much a higher ideological.
Yeah. That is mentioned in both of these, but because both of these actually take place, you don't actually see it in that period. You see it, all you see is kind of the post-war period. So that's just something that people refer back to.
Well, you alluded to Bright's Every Visit, where they have picnics under the tree and they're studying in the forecourts of the Cambridge spires, and that's where they fermented their initial ideas from, isn't it?
And that's what you see in the Cambridge Spies serial, the one that you are talking about. Yeah.
Any more questions? Then I think, thank you very much to the panel. And I release you all to tea and coffee outside of the room. Thank you very much.